Greetings in the name of the Most High. Zeph Daniel here, your host, the Desert Wanderer, Desert Prophet, little P. No F, please. Well, no, I don't want to. I do want a prophet, but I don't want a prophet by speaking about the things of God or things of spirit. Suffice to say, I've bugged a lot of people over the years, people who, for whatever reason, they just feel bothered when you talk about the things of spirit, the things of, you know, that because it leads to, the spirit leads to truth. The truth leads to waking up. Waking up, you start realizing, hey, the world is kind of like a confab. Uh-oh. You know, and then it leads to, gee, we were all conformed zombies. Is that what it was? And it's like, so here's the thing they don't like. Realizing that at long last, after all the music, just bread and circus, baby. It's not important at all, don't you understand? None of the music was important. None of the movies were important. None of the entertainment was important. None of the goodies were important. It's all bread and circus. It's all provided so that you stay on the page. Don't stop believing. Oh yeah, baby. That song is iconic. 80s signature song. Don't stop believing. Typical hypnosis programming 101. Oh, they probably don't. You know, they probably romanticize the whole thing, as everybody did in the 80s. I certainly didn't have a clue what was going on. But that song, it was like, they're singing about the hypnosis. I mean, they're singing about the conformity. They're singing about the belief in the world system. Don't stop believing. Hold on to that feeling. You know, he hopped a train going anywhere. Yeah, the romance of the old America, the American dream. Never existed, really, not really. Not really. It's been a struggle. America's done some awfully awesome things, like the revolution. Would America rise up now? No, America's divided by the PC police. And don't stop believing in them. Or they're going to get mad and spank you. The biggest spokesman now is one Quentin Tarantino. Such a genius. Ah, yeah, well, you got me bright and early. Yes, okay, I'm starting and stopping. You got me bright. You got me not bright, but early and dark. Because, well, there's pressing things we need to talk about. The Lord does not get me up at this hour and waste it. And I just had my vitamin C, a huge dose, so that, you know, I take non-China C that is a nutraceutical, you know, the finest C. It looks like a drug, actually. It's powder, very fine powder. And you get it from vitamincfoundation.org, the best source of learning about C and all things C. I also take Live-On Tabs. It's Lipo-C, which is C in fat, so it doesn't go through your system. And then I take a mineral, and I take EFAs. You know, I take organic EFAs, and I must say, I mean, I talk to a lot of men with man issues at our age, and mine have improved with the way I eat and the way I supplement and so forth. I keep it very simple, you know. I don't need more B vitamins because I get plenty through organic free range meats and so forth. And I've just been, you know, I mean, whatever works for anybody. I've just been quietly on my own path. But I mean, the good news is, well, I would love more sleep. I gave up sleeping in my 50s. But no, the Lord gets me up, and then I get a few more hours, and then, you know, sometimes it's a split thing like that. But I think the worst thing to do is when there's something up in the spirit, I'm up at that hour, and to just sit there and have your mind racing around and all that is the problem with that is, you know, there's something up, there's something you need to deal with. If you allow yourself to be idle with your thoughts, oftentimes the enemy can come in and steal that inspiration that you had, and so you're left with nothing. So we're trying to take advantage of this fire drill here. Okay, let's get to addressing the needs, and I had some scripture to read here to you. We're going to go to a psalm, and I can't tell you which one until I see it again. Why they put these in alphabetical order, and then okay. First, we're going to do some, we're going to look at Job here. And so we're ministering to hurting people, okay. I am as one mocked of his neighbor who calleth upon God, and he answereth him, the just upright man is laughed to scorn. Now, this is another verse. I have to line these verses up because this is one I need to give to a friend today who, you know, took issue with the fact that people would become willing laughing stocks and mocking stocks, if you will. And it says right here, once again, I am one mocked of his neighbor, mocked by the neighbor, who calleth upon God, and he answereth him, the just upright man is laughed to scorn. Just upright would be a man of God. You know, it doesn't mean not a sinner, but it means a man of God. We'll stop. We'll just consider that verse for a second, because that, I guess, you know, we'll call this to the fence sitters. Hello, fence sitters. You're more than welcome here, but I'm not going to repeat the same thing over and over to you and prove implacably and irrefutably the truth. You know, the truth doesn't need me to prove it. You already know it. So, you know, there's nothing I can do to convince you of anything. And the reason is because God has to choose you. This is what I told to a young friend. I said, look, I can explain it. I can present the gospel, you know, as best I can, which is pretty great the way I do it. I mean, you know, I have to admit, I am extremely gifted in putting the case to, I can make the case so perfect that that Christians get mad at me, right? They become unmasked because most of the professional ones that you see online that make their living from online ministries and things, they're you know, they just like everything else in this world, they're wearing a mask. It's not real. You know, well, the litmus test, I mean, the Lord, you know, had me repent on the donations. I needed them back when I had them, but I had to repent of it when it got to the point where I could support it on my own, because Lord provides for me and I provide for the website, you know, and that's the way it works. And I realized I felt so free after taking the donation thing off. After I just felt like, I mean, I felt free in the spirit, like I could speak my mind. And I realized that for years, not that I was consciously ever pulling punches, but, you know, every once in a while there'd be a punch pulled, depending, you know. And, you know, not, I don't think anything bad happened. But, you know, just like over the last 2 years, there has been more podcasts that did not go up than did because I am flawed, you know. So before you think I'm boasting, look at what I have to face here. A pod that seems perfectly good to me, but it doesn't get up there. And I've had them where I put them up there, and somehow it doesn't get, it just, and then all of a sudden I feel guilty. And I've told Angie, no, we can't go with that. I just realized I made too many mistakes, or I made mistakes. So you have more hours on the cutting room floor than you do up there, and if I make one mistake, the entire pod is out. No, it does. It's got nothing to do with the flat Earth. You know, the flat Earthers think I'm making a mistake, and the round Earther. No, I'm here. You know, with you. I have. Look, my conclusion is gone, and I've stated this over and over again. But my conclusion is that it doesn't really matter what it is, because I'm not interested right now, because it's not my concern. It's not my concern whether it's flat, round, this or that, or anything else. I do believe there's a psyop going on with this flat Earth thing, and you have to be very careful with things like that. You can be distracted for years. I think what they're, the psyop that they're running is trying to, whip up, dissent against the government or whatever. I don't know, But what I can say is this: because of the nature of this life, the interdimensionality of it, and the fact it's controlled from off stage, by others, and it's like a gauntlet we're running through, or we're being tested, we're being tried. Because that's really what it is, and we're all kind of Trumans on the Truman Show in a way. Except, it's real. God wants us to go through it, and He wants us to have loving, good relations with people, not mock the creation. He created this. He runs this. And if we have redress issues, we take it to the Lord, because if you pull apart the thing and go, well, it's all fake, this is fake, then Christianity is fake, then, or rather, the Bible's fake, then Jesus is fake, then Yahweh is fake. I've seen it. And then Saturn's, but what's real? Saturn, I've seen that. And all these other kind of angles, they try to push the satanic agenda, on all these different fronts. And all I can tell you is, I dance with the one who brung me, that is the Lord God, okay? If it has a Judeo background in what I'm talking about, that's the one who brung me. That's all I know. I rejected Jesus and rejected the Bible when I was a child and growing up, rejected it all the way until I hit the wall. But it was this God in the Bible, who reached down to this lost soul and pulled me up, and I have not looked back since. So I've sorry, I've been all through Hinduism, Buddhism, atheism, this ism, that ism. I've been through all the isms. And I just tell you, Jesus is it. That's my way. And I'm sorry that he's been tainted, made to look like a fool, and mocked. Oh, yes, mocking him has never stopped. And I'm very proud to say, in a good way, that I have been mocked and laughed at since I was a child. And now I count it all for good. It's all a blessing that I was able to do that for the Lord, because it wasn't for me. I felt sorry for myself, like Job, you see. But what was, remember Jeremiah? Now, what is this in Job 12? We were in Job 12. Just if you want to go reference it, I just highly recommend Job right now. What is the thing about Job now? He's mocked and laughed at. Mocked and laughed at. Okay. What's the prerequisite for being a man of God? I mean, what is the proof out there? Because you're laughed at and mocked, that is your proof. No laughed at and mocked, you ain't doing it right. You got a problem. Your problem's with the Lord. You're not hooked up. You're still connected to the world, maybe. But yes, laughed and mocked and laughed at and mocked has been the central theme, and humiliated and set up with gang stalking and anything to make me feel bad and ashamed, and then mocked and laughed at in that shame and humiliation. Yes, absolutely. That's been their central numero uno thing that they've done to me. That's been the main theme throughout. That's what got me wired all the wrong way. That's what shaped my behavior into just horribly. And that's what I had to deal with. I just didn't realize it, See what I mean? I didn't, A lot of times things happen to you and you behave a certain way, and it's not really you. I mean, I behave a certain way that wasn't me. I was just being manipulated by them, and I'm sure very pleasing to them, as I ended up humiliating myself. and becoming an object of scorn and ridicule and laughter, because they wanted it. And I didn't realize I was being programmed to, you know, like a trained SEAL. But, you know, when I look back on it, the blessing is, you want to know what the blessing of all that is? I'm still here. Had I not agreed to I guess, go along in my own way, which I didn't know I was doing. I mean, you know, right? But, you know, they see somebody that's of God that's, you know, big and strong and yeah, tough and rough. Oh boy, all guns ablaze. Everyone drops what they're doing and targets that man to break him down. So yeah, they broke me down and I got broken down and then I was laughed at. In front of them, I was broken down and laughed at and scorned and whatever else. So just a great gay old time. And they just thought it was... I use the word gay, not in the term that, you know, the worlders use it. I'm using actual language here, you know, not PC police BS, okay? If that's what you are, you're a lefty. If you're like, you know, the Quentin Tarantino's in the news. I never really, you know, I liked a couple of his films, but I mean, I just generally stay away. And now I realize why I do, because it's just all propaganda. He's just a PC a-hole, you know, that's all he is, just... a propagandist. He's not an artist. But I'm glad that's finally come out. I'm glad he got demasked. And so, you know, I do not plan on, you know, not, I'm not boycotting him. I'm just not led to see anything he has anything to do with at all. And but he's a darling of the left, and they love this controversy, so he can use his new fame and platform to say white privilege now. So he's going beyond the cops now. He's on to white privilege. It's like, so, therefore, Tarantino, I guess you won't be making any more movies because you have white privilege. You should just sit down and shut the F up and never do it again. And, you know, when whatever distribution money you get from your films, you should just give all that to whoever, you know, the minority of your choice. Good news for you. The majority in this country will be Hispanic and is heading that way, followed by Chinese. And the blacks are just kind of like the whites. They're just going to take a back seat. So it's going to be Hispanic privilege, if you really want to call it right. Because, I mean, there won't be any white people around anyway. They're being bred out of here. Same with Europe. Why that's happening, and it's being like, I don't see race, so I don't care. You know, to me, it doesn't matter. The racists are the left, and they always have been. And they were the KKK, and they were have a big... easy to view history of leftist racism, divide, conquer, they're perverts, whatever else. They want to change all the laws that have anything to do with the Bible. They hate God, and they, you know, it's the godless God. It's the God-hating left is really what it is. And most Republicans are leftists. They're in that same, you know, totalitarian mode. They become totalitarian. You know, it starts. They start saying they're liberal, but then they're really left, and then they want to bring immorality in and have force people to conform to it, and then they want to kill anyone that does not believe like they do. Ultimately, if you let them go, that you become Adolf Hitler, because Adolf Hitler was a leftist. So is Stalin, Mao, all that, and Pol Pot and the rest of them. They're all leftists. They all love, you know, big totalitarian, you know, they're dictators. And eventually they just kill hundreds of millions of people who have the wrong mindset. And if you let the PC police continue like they are, they will eventually just execute people for having the wrong thought. It goes to such a level of absurdity, it's beyond absurd. But yes, don't never forget they're your enemy, okay? So a guy like Tarantino, you know, he is the enemy. You know, it's just that simple. We are obviously ancient enemies. I want nothing from him. I've, you know, just look at him like some other kind of animal in the jungle, you know, and that one you just stay away from. That's all. And I'm sure he feels the same way about me. I mean, if he knew me, you know. But I'm glad I don't know him. We have nothing in common. There really is no common ground. The leftist is actually humanity hating ultimately. And, you know, their decisions lead to a great destruction of humanity, always. And it's trackable through time and through history. And if you want to look it up on the net, go ahead. look at the big black book of communism, and you'll just be horrified. Horrified at the atrocities. Horrified. Absolutely horrified. ISIS is a leftist front group, too. Yes. It's funded and managed completely solely by the United States of America, in your name, by the way, and being used to herald in this flooding of the immigrant crisis situation, which is confabulated by the left, again. So it's the conquering of Europe by the Muslims. We've been there, done that. We will never conform to that. They've done it before where they took over Europe. It's a Muslim invasion, and the people are being killed. And you're watching it. You're watching World War III take place before your very eyes. And you're not doing anything, but you're waiting. You're wondering if you're going to be killed. Yes, they're going to kill you too. And I think that whatever your spiritual view is, you know, whatever your view is at all about the world system and all that, I know most people who are stuck in the world system hate Satan and they hate themselves for being there, but they figure they just got to make a living and there's no other way. Well, you know, I know it appears that way. You know, they got to believe in what's practical, not magic. But the thing is that's all shifting now, isn't it? Like shifting quicksand. The thing that but the rest of what I talk about, most people, you know, that are even in the system and whatnot, they agree with me basically on almost everything I've said. They agree with me about the military, what a just nation should be, what good leadership should be, all of that. You know, where we disagree is on this on spirituality. We disagree there. It's because I've had an experience with the Lord and they haven't, is really what it is. And I can't make them have it. It's God's timing. So they're not willing to give that up because they just feel that, you know, they already have God in their hearts and they're doing what they have to do. They're bowing their knee, but not their hearts, to the world system. And at the same time, they believe they're serving God. And so they desperately disagree with me and they feel that I'm completely wrong. And that the suffering that I've been through has been all self-inflicted wounds, and that it didn't have to be that way. It's just that there's a, you know, somehow just it's tragic what happened, whatever they feel, you know what I mean? But, and they feel like they need to put it on that, they need to put it in that light. You know, what, being an artist, being a misfit, is that something new? Isn't that kind of a cliche? When you get the artist defending the world system, that's really hilarious. That's not artist. Artist is one who speaks truth to power, not, you know, takes it up the ass. You know, come on. You know what I mean? I'm sorry to be blunt, but that's really quite literally how it is. Whether you know, I mean, people can lie to you, but you know, don't kid yourself. You know, it's a very, very hard and fast line between the two. But the reason they disagree with me, I mean, I've had people actually say they would commit suicide if I'm right. And so you see, we can't, I want them to be able to listen in here without feeling like they need to commit suicide. And we're just going to kind of wait on the Lord together because they know I'm right. I mean, deep down, they know that the Lord is who saves. And that when you're with him, you don't look left, right, or back. You go straight ahead with him. And if they're going to mock you, they're going to throw rocks at you, they're going to do whatever they're going to do, is proof of your faith and proof of your birth as a son of the Most High God. Now, we just looked at Job. We looked at Jeremiah. All the prophets treated the same way. The early church treated the same way. They're all treated the same way. Why should I expect to get off light? Well, I have gotten off light now. I mean, I feel like I've also been restored of things that were stolen from me and all this. But I have to trust the Lord to get me through, you know. And I have to trust the Lord to make a table in the midst of my enemies, Psalm 23. I have to trust the Lord to actually survive, to help me in business so that, you know, we don't have tragedies there. That's very delicate all the time. And, you know, you make mistakes and we've certainly made more than our share. And, you know, but somehow the ship gets righted and, you know, hey, look, I'm just, you know, feel blessed to be here and have, you know, some kind of shelter and be able to talk to you and be able to talk about this stuff. But no, you people that are in the world system, don't go away. you know what's going to happen if you out there. You know what they're going to do. You're just going to go back to Disneyland and start playing pretend again. And I know you don't want that. Now, I'm not going to criticize you because, you know, a lot of people that I'm friends with, they're all kind of in a process of like exodus, okay, to be honest. And, you know, they don't feel so fervent about defending the world system anymore to me like they used to a few years ago. So I think we've made progress, in terms of consciousness, or God has made progress in the hearts of men. You know, I'm very encouraged. I'm very hopeful of what I see, what I'm experiencing. So I'm just, I say you're welcome here. You know, especially the aging rock star. It's like, well, I do music as a quest, as a journey, as a thing, and maybe you did it for money. I mean, there's, so maybe that's why you're not into it anymore. See, to me, it was like surfing, it was like, I was the soul surfer type, I had the longboard and I just never really gave that up. There was just something about, just the kind of the zen of surfing, it's just a really, it didn't matter if anyone was there or not. I was fine just by myself, in the elements. And then there's another surfer that has to have a crowd there to watch him while he goes up and does his aerial, 360s, or they go around two times now or three times, I don't know what you call that, they have, helicopters, I guess, whatever. And they're able to do all these fancy maneuvers, and they always get a crowd around to watch. And it's like they need to compete for money, they need to compete with each other, and they need a crowd there to watch. And the idea of just being into it for the sheer, what if you have a surf spot where there's nobody there, like I had the benefit of when I was a kid. Now it's so crowded everywhere, but, I had that, And it was just me, dolphins, porpoises, and nice waves. Like I remember quite often during the week in the, throughout the year when I would surf at Zuma Beach, there'd be like, I'd have my own peak there and there'd be like no one there. And then eventually people would show up. And that's about the time I'm just going in, because I had all of it to myself. I didn't have a crowd. It was just being on the wave, and just kind of like being in the ocean, and just that experience, was really what it was about for me. And so music is really very similar to it, because I sort of traded one in for the other, because music is surfing, So with me, it's just, I don't know. I'm addicted to mixing, though. I mean, I like it better than surfing, because the sonic journey is what I'm on. So the speaking part of it, this part of it, it's all connected. The music and speaking and communication and the sound and sound. So it's all about sound, And to me, that's why I'm not really, I kind of did some videos, but I shied away from it, because with me, it's all about the sound. The sound is the journey. And when you have a podcast that's 3 hours, and sometimes I'm aware that you just need 3 hours to chill out. So you can put the podcast on and you don't have to look at a video or strain your eyes or anything. You can close your eyes and just, here we are together kind of going down the spiritual highway. And, a big part of it has been, trying to convince the fence sitters to get off the fence. And part of that is just, there's an absurdity in that, which I'm going to address in a moment. Well, I'll address it now. The absurdity in that is that, unless God brings you, you ain't got no one to dance with. So it's just like God's got to do the reaching in and grabbing you. And, it's all about him and what he does and what he does in your life. But I know that if you just beg him right now to take you in, I think he probably will. I don't see why not, but then I don't know, ultimately. It's not up to me, and I'm glad it's not. And I can't convince you. It's that nobody can convince anyone to give their soul to Jesus Christ. You can't do it intellectually. He has to draw you in. The Father draws you know, you to the sun, you know. It's just, it's almost like a metaphor of to the actual sun, the source of energy, the source of life. The source of life has to draw you into the source of life. And then take the veil from your eyes. Because Jesus isn't just Jesus, it's the cosmos. it's the power behind the cosmos. It's the truth. It's a way. It's a waveform. You know. So I just can't. Well, when you talk about it like that, it sounds appealing. I understand. But there are rules, and we're not equipped to follow the rule. Believe me. Now, I would, if I was in the world system, like, you know, from the beginning, watch out. I would tear it up. I mean, I know what I'm capable of, and I would basically be at the very top. But that's my status in my world. I'm at the very, you know, well, there's no ranking in my world. Everyone's at the top. All people are equal. All angelic beings, whatever we call us when we're home, we're at the very, there is no, like, gee, you're above me. One day I'm going to get up. No, there is no pecking order. That's Luciferian. That's actually reptilian. That's not us. We're all equal. If you're a son of the Most High, you're a son of the Most High. There's no, like, well, here's a more powerful angel. No, more powerful in the eyes of men, but more or less important or powerful in the eyes of God? No. Everything functions. You know, it's the cosmos. Everything functions beautifully, and you can't remove anything from God's creation and have it function beautifully. So everything is vitally important. Everything is sacred. Everyone's important. Everyone's a star. Remember that song? Yeah, by Sly and the Family Stone. Everybody is a star. Makes no difference. Da, 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 da. Ah, that was some great music back then. Boy, I tell you, where's that kind of music now? That was, you know, very godly kind of song. And it was on, you know, on the FM radio with all the Satanists. Well, you know, he probably had a hard time with drugs and everything because probably, you know, his soul was in the balance and he was caught between. I know he believes in God. You could tell that from the music. But he was in he's been embattled. And from what I understand, he was homeless and living in a van and he couldn't get any recording time. This was one of the most brilliant, you know, recording artists of all time. You know, living in a, you know, I guess maybe the Lord's doing a work there. That's what it seemed like to me. He's been rescued out of the world system. But, you know, bad reputation, drugs, all this stuff sounds like gang stalking to me. Sure does. So, you know, I have compassion. You know, you hear things about people like that, and go, oh, yeah, you see, he's really fallen. It's like, oh, no, it's a, but hey, there's a guy the Lord's dealing with. You know, I look at it that way. You know, like that's some kind of brother there, you know. We better pray, you know, that the Lord keeps him. And, you know, a lot of times he breaks those he loves, you see. He broke me. Oh, yes, all the people around mocking and all this and then breaking me down. Yeah, they had their way with me. They loved it. They love watching me suffer and watching me feel guilty and watching me be ashamed. They loved it. And then when I finally got all the way down to where they were just laughing and pointing, you know, just it was just so funny to them. You know, that's when I realized that God had let them do that because he was breaking me all the way to zero because, you know, I'm the kind of person that I can't move, unless it's all the way down to like, this is it, I ain't going to learn. It takes something that severe. And he got my attention, boy, I tell you. And then I realized that, you know, all that breaking down and all that, and all that humiliation and mocking and laughter and all the, you know, the games and the false narratives and the fake story and the fake this and fake friends and fake this and fake that and, you know, Truman Show-esque kind of life that I had then. Well, I feel terribly sorry for the participants of that game that was surrounding me, and I feel sorry for how much money was spent, you know, in setting some kind of weird, you know, fantasy world up. You know, but in the end of the day, I'm so grateful to the Lord, that's all. And everything had to be exactly as it was for me to survive, because anything Because if, like I say, if you're a big, strong man, you know, you got it going on, and you don't need anybody, and you're going to do your own thing, and, you know, you're like Esau, right? Well, unless you're an ultimate warrior, they're going to get you, and they're going to break you down, but they start in on your mind, and they throw witchcraft on you, and they do this, they do that, and they're all around you, you know? They just start, you know, but the Lord can keep them out, but, you know, I wasn't exactly serving the Lord. So here's what's happening. I'm getting broken down. I couldn't fight them. They broke me into a million pieces. And they would actually take bets on when I was going to kill myself. And they would gamble on where I would go, whether I'd kill myself, how I'm going to deal with this next onslaught, whether someone would kill me, whether I'd wind up being a sacrifice on the altar of Satan, or blah, 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 take your pick. And so every week they'd be tuning in to the Zeph show to watch, you know, what would happen. I kid you not, and it was very structured. You know, it was basically like being on closed circuit TV. You know, it was mega gang stalking. It was beyond gang stalking because it was like everywhere I go, everyone I see, everything, they're all completely connected into this story, which is me. It's like, and then they'd say, well, you think the world revolves around you? Yes, yes, now that I look back on it, yes, it does. It did anyway. It sure did. It revolved around me. And people couldn't get enough. They've always watched me since I was like a little kid, you know. People watch, you know, to what's going to happen. And I remember I talked to my old writing partner. He was not exactly, you know, I'm ambivalent. I owe him a call back, and I'm just like, are you going to be reporting back to, like, the handlers and controllers like last time? So maybe I just don't feel that motivated to talk because, I mean, before it was like, you know, being betrayed all the time. You know, I mean, I hate to say it that way, but he'd be reporting back to the people, you know, on what's that, you know, maybe someone wants to find out about me or something and they're using him. I mean, you know, I see, it was just like that, only just everywhere. You know, it's beyond gang stalking because it's in your face, it's in your house, it's in your bed, it's in your, you know what I mean? It's everywhere. It's everything. I called it Saturn. The whole thing's Saturn, you know, and obviously, you know, they felt very confident that they sort of had me in the bag. So they didn't get rid of me because I was at one point, I guess, their entertainment. They found it very amusing that, you know, and they wanted me to tell them all about it when I would suffer. You want to tell me all about it? And now bark like a dog. I mean, you know, just you name it, they would do it. They would say it. And it was very, very traumatizing to the point where I didn't even know my own. I look in the mirror, see nothing. That's how, you know, right? And that's still that way. You know, I never really did recover from that. Nope, I never recovered from it. I got hurt real bad, and I never recovered from it. The Lord didn't restore me in that way. The Lord just kept me broken, and I'm His, you know, and through Him, through me, just fine, thank you very much. Me as a big, strong man, that's not going to work. My courage, my strength, my anything that I have here with the Zeph Report, which is pretty ferocious, but it's not me being ferocious. I'm broken, so He can use me to talk. And I say things that no one else will say. And then you go, wow, that's real courage. It's not courage, I'm broken. Let's see. If they want to, you know, have their way with me, kill me, they could do it any time, and they have had their way with me in that way, but the Lord kept me alive. But I mean, I couldn't fight that off. Now, everything that happens or doesn't happen, I have to rely on the Lord. I can't really defend myself. Nor do I want to. See, if I was a big, strong man like Esau, you know, God hated Esau, but He loved Jacob. Remember that story in the Bible? Well, go ahead and do some reading about it. Just look online, Esau versus Jacob, or Esau, the story of Esau and Jacob, and how God dealt with each one. Now Esau was what you would call a big, strong man, but it was the world system that made him big. He was a leader among men, and he had scores and scores of companies. Back in those days, a man was judged by how many concubines he would have. How many, you know, right? Well, it's just the way it was. God allowed it, sure. Multiple wives, whatever. You know, that was, you know, pretty much the norm. But the thing is that things changed over time. But I mean, that's, you know, obviously, if you have more than one wife and it's allowed, then it wouldn't be adultery if you have, you know, multiple relations. And in a sense, more if you have three or four wives and they all have children, then you're populating the earth. You know what I mean? So and then finally, we're in a stage right now of decline, of declining birth rates for people that have gone a certain trajectory. And maybe the Lord's just taking us out. I don't know. But in terms of, no, and I understand that you say, well, I don't want to go through that horror. And it's like, well, you know, when you're broken down, like one of the reasons I had to go through that horror is because I was so strong. See, and I was very strong-willed. And I did have a very fast intellect, you know, to figure things out. And I was, you know, very confident. And so they, you know, so this has been, you know, the breakdown. And then I wouldn't seem to learn from being broken down and suicidal and all that. And they stalked me right into suicide. And then that didn't clip me. And then it starts all over again. And then you believe the world is a certain thing and you try to do your best. And pretty soon you find people breaking you down again. It's like, wait a second. What exactly did I do wrong? And so that was my way, but it was because I was so headstrong. When I was broken, I wouldn't just lie down and let the count go to 10 and, you know, and lose. I'd fight back. And even when I had nothing, I'd still fight back. And that's why it just was a long process of breaking. If the Lord breaks you and you go to the Lord, if had I done that back then, it would have been a very different story. There would have been a lot less abuse. The abuse was my fault, ultimately. I brought it on myself because of the fact that I wouldn't just give it up to the Lord. I wouldn't just be broken. But then again, all the angels and the Lord and everything around them, they all loved watching me fight back. Everyone loved it. But it was like fighting, you know, trying to stop Niagara Falls from, you know, it was silly. But at the same time, the fact that I was willing to believe it could be done, and I would step into the ring and get my ass kicked every time, it was still, you know, and have the witches cackling. And oh, how they loved it. Well, now, of course, they can't show their faces around here. Are you kidding? You know, it's very transparent now. There is actually, you know, I have a prophetic statement to make. The tide has turned. They look like deer in the headlights now. They see an end to themselves. My goodness. But we're all children of God in a way. Maybe some of them will, you know, give up their war against God, which is what witchcraft is. It's self-willed, but see, they have a collective. They draw their strength from the collective, where I was an individual. How could I fight the collective? I can fight hundreds of millions of people who all, the force, you use the force, Luke, all using the force and beaming it on me. How could I fight that? I couldn't. I got broken. But yes, you know, humans thinking that they had a little secret, you know, area of abusing, you know, me. They figured no one's, you know, that's okay. You know how people are. You know how kids are, with, right? You know how people are. So they felt justified in, like, if I tested them, it's like, it's okay with you if I die. Ha ha, high fives all around. Oh, look, he killed himself. Yeah! Just like that. It was just like that. Friends that I had loved, you know, being demasked, and then that they were these seething people who couldn't wait to steer me in a game into a losing streak, so I would kill myself, and then cashing in on the money. Well, once you can stomach that, and that the Lord showed me all that, and you know, he brought me up on all that, and he showed me every incident that ever happened. Hey, you people that did all these incidents, well, a lot of you aren't here anymore, but those who still are left, God saw everything you did. you don't get a free abuse victim, you know, that's separate from everything. It's okay to kick this one. Go ahead. No. It's all lined up, and when you get to see the Lord, you know, the Lord's going to show you what you did. And he's going to deal with you on that regard. And you're going to have to deal with it on that regard. You're going to have to confess that sin of attacking God through his children while you're asking God and begging God to save you. No worries. Paul was a persecutor of Christians, so don't worry about it. But you still have to deal. Well, there's nothing worse than a child being abused mentally and spiritually into believing that he is a shameful thing that should not show his face. I think that's a terrible thing to bully people into that traumatized state. And, you know, every time they try to speak up or have an idea, to browbeat them back down into their trauma. And then hopefully they'll kill themselves, you know, or they'll just be pathetic zombie slaves. That level of cruelty is as bad as it gets out there. I mean, I guess the worst thing would be they just start dismembering you or something, you know, while telling you how much they love you. I mean, whatever, you know, but it's that level of abuse. People do that when they think they're getting away with something. You know, like a lot of you who are TIs, you know, they feel like it's okay. A lot of them say they believe in God who stalk you. I've had Christian stalkers. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. They're part of the collective, and they're part of that. Proverbs 1 is your chapter. You want to see who the stalkers are, read Proverbs 1, and you'll have all your questions answered. Very so. The Bible has all the answers to all this stuff. The mocking and laughing and beating you down and breaking you down like the Job, Jeremiah, the prophets. Is very, very common in the Bible, but somehow the pastors don't teach it. They teach conformity and bowing down to the government or whatever, the powers that be. Which, you know, the Psalms are another good remedy. David being lied to, surrounded, people plotting against him, mocking him also. You know, this mocking thing is really, when Elijah was mocked by the boys who thought that, you know, he was being mocked for having no hair. You know, the next thing that you know, a bear comes up and kills the two boys. I think there were two, if I'm not mistaken. I could be wrong. But I believe that they were mocking him, and then they got killed. I think the mocking and laughing is something that, you know, I know when you do it to Satanists, they freak out and they go insane. But when you do it to God's children, and of course that's how you have war with God. When you're at war with God, what do? You look for those not conformed to the satanic system, which is basically reality 101, okay? And those who don't quite get it or don't belong there, you target them for extinction and with extreme prejudice. But you want to set it up like the movie Carrie, where you set up the most horrible trauma that you could imagine doing to somebody. And then you sit back and watch as like a delicious treat as you mock and you laugh and point. Now, just so happens, I can tell you this is inside baseball here. I'm going to tell you something really seriously prophetic. Everything here is prophetic today. I'll get deep into the prophetic, though. See, God hates that. If you just killed the person, he would like you more. This mocking and the setups and the stalking and the sitting back and, you know, kind of almost pleasuring yourself at the at how delicious your plan was to destroy this child, this innocent one. See, right there. Now let's hold that emotion. Hold that. That right there is the thing he hates probably the most of anything. And his wrath is, and you can see it unfolding right now, yes? Is so severe in this regard. It's so severe that he actually doesn't just make the person suffer and beg for God to take them, but he rejects them, and then he makes them as if they never were in the first place. And it goes beyond that too. I said, like, as if they never were, but then they are, you know, obviously eternally in shame. And, you know, he wants them to be conscious of just what they lost. So they go to God looking for absolution, saying, I was guilty. And God says, well, what did you do? Well, I did this, and I stalked, and I drove people to suicide, and I, you know, were they children? Were they innocent? Yes, they were innocent, and you know, they didn't even know what the world was. I mean, they were just traumatized at an early age and hurt, and they were just pinpricked and hurt and tortured, and finally it was maybe a relief when they committed suicide because of how badly they were treated and bullied and lied to and mocked and set up in these various dramas and games so they would have maximum trauma and maximum pain and suffering. I see. And so I'm with you, Jesus. Oh, wait a second. Yes, let me just put this millstone around your neck and drown you. No, I'm sorry. Your fate that awaits you is worse than the drowning. And so, you know, you are not... You've had it with the bullying now, have you? You really learned your lesson now, haven't you? I'm ready to go with you, Lord. Not so fast. Not so fast. You look for me, speaking for God here, you look for me, but you shall not find me, except you will find me in the tip of a sword that you will stab yourself with in the heart. And that will be your mercy. So that's how the Lord feels about it. I mean, you know, just giving a kind of a, you know, in my own words, you know, my own way of presenting it. But I mean, it's that picking on the children, you know, on the end. You wouldn't believe. He cries too. He weeps and he. It's that thing that he hates the most of it. I'm telling you, that is the wrath of God on steroids comes on that. It's that, you know, that took out Sodom and Gomorrah, you know, is that gang stalking that, you know, think about these traumatized people now, you know, becoming shut-ins, and I know quite a few, and I've been there myself, you know. The old neighbor here, I mean, she mocked me one time. She was like, I saw her on the road and I was driving in. And she goes, what are you doing out by yourself? Like, I need Trish to you know, it's like, you know, they could pick you up. You know, there was just this mocking and laughing. And I go, I just sort of got through it, you know. But I mean, that's, and then a horrible fate befell her. And I'm so sorry, but I can't. She just thought it was funny. Hilarious. What are you doing out by yourself? Yes, mocking God. Yes, openly mocking God and figuring I'm too stupid to just understand what she just said. You know, figuring I'd just go with the surface reality of what she had said rather than the real meaning, which was ha 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 mocking. No, I never forgot it. See, I tend to never forget things like that. Well, they say, well, let it go. Well, I let things go, but I don't forget. Every little thing like that, all the way back into my history, I remember. Because the Lord remembers it. And, you know, I mean, it's a lesson to me, too. I mean, when I was real young, I was kind of strong, and I, you know, would fall into bullying, too. You know, bullying people. Not on purpose. I was just a little kid, but I... You know, with all the stalking and bullying and all the stuff that happened, I really learned about that, not to do that, you know. And so I had friends that were victims of that, and I could see, you know, they were just the kind of people, I guess, that maybe even I would pick on, you know, at a really young age. And then I learned from my brother and his experience. He didn't make it, by the way. So, you know, and, you know, I guess, you know, he was a laughing stock and a mocked and set up and lied to, and he was treated really bad, way worse than me. I mean, I didn't get anything like that. And he didn't make it. When he died, it in some way it was a relief because his suffering was over, and I know he went with the Lord because he believed in the Lord. But it would be things like he wanted to volunteer at the church, and they banned him from the property. Now, he was had an Asperger kind of thing, so he was socially inappropriate, and, you know, I mean, there were things, you know, that you know, he was weird in that way, you know. It was a congenital issue with him, and it wasn't his fault. But you see, because he was different, how he was treated. And, of course, the Lord hated that. And then the Lord, and I suppose, you know, I wasn't the nicest brother either. And then I got my ass kicked after that, so that I learned what he went through. And I didn't get away scot-free from being a, you know, pretty lousy brother. And at times I wasn't, but I just, you know, I didn't understand. And then finally after being, no, it's okay now, I don't feel guilty. I was ignorant. I was ignorant. I didn't do anything on purpose. I just wasn't, you know, the best brother. Well, anyway, but I would be now the best brother, you see, after the Lord's had his way with me. So then I have friends that are like him, you know, and we get along great. And a lot of total mutual respect. And that could not have been possible without the breaking. So again, I thank the Lord. I said, keep me broken, Lord, because, you know, I just, broken meaning I can have any kind of idea I want, and that's fine. But the fact of the matter is, it's his way, not mine. Well, if you're already broken, I mean, I suppose, and, you know, you're crying out to the Lord for help with this being stalked and mocked and all that. It's like, remember, before you, everybody else got that treatment too, you know? But the reason you put up with it is because you love the Lord so much, and you know you're actually, the benefit that you're getting is you're living an upright life. Remember that word, upright. And you're going to, you know, from life to life here. You know, they're already dead. The mockers and scorners and whatever they are, the collective, they're already dead. They're just demons and ghouls, pretty much. Sock puppets, you know. They're already dead. You know, I mean, in a spiritual sense. You're alive. And the other thing, here's the other part of it. No matter how good or bad you are, you know, what your virtues are or not, you're a light unto the world. You know, as Jesus was, you are. And if you're not in the world system, you're a big light. They want to put all the lights out. If they put all the lights out, they would not exist in the first place, but they don't know that. You know, they kill the goose with a golden egg or whatever. You actually give them life by being there, because without you, you know, say if everyone committed suicide on the same day, they would have no reason to live, because their entire existence revolves around this issue. Their entire existence revolves around the light. Their entire existence is dependent on God through his children, without whom they would not exist. And I've been, you know, and I know that people don't understand that axiomatic statement, but that's literal truth, and it's hard to take. But that's literal truth. Hey, it's all right. I remember I was in a tattoo shop. I got one little tattoo here that says Holy Spirit's on my wrist. And I got that when I was writing the book Lamb. And I, you know, I didn't go decorate my whole body with tattoos. I just did that one thing. And it was to remind me of who was in charge when I was writing the book Lamb, because the Lord wanted it written. I had no idea what the story was going to be about or anything, you know. And so it's probably it'll be, you know, after I'm out of here, it'll probably become, you know, more widely read, I would think. You know, because it's kind of an important book. And, you know, it's a big epic story anyway. But it's in terms of understanding the prophetic nature of interdimensionality and what we're going through now. It was written back in 2001, and published in, you know, 2002. And it was mocked by Christians. Even though it had scripture quotes and it was talking about the Lord, and there was, you know, mocked because the main criticism, may I tell you why it was mocked, besides the fact it comes from me. So naturally, anything from me has to be mocked. But why they mocked it, why they were angry with me for writing it, was because it lifts up the meek. I guess I did a really good job, or God did, you know, because I'm a broken vessel, so I'm writing. It's like, okay, well, I'll just show up and write, you know. I don't know. I can't take any credit because I've, you know, is it really me? I don't know. And you know, it was about the disconnected and the broken of our society being the heroes of God, being lifted, right? It's the schizophrenic kid in the mental hospital. He became the prophet. It's the homeless guy, you know. They're like the anointed angels, see? You know what I'm saying? And then, oh, they got so mad. Oh my God, so mad. Because they say, you know, your problem, Zeph, is that, you know, God is working with these other people that are, you know, in the world or whatever. They took great issue with the fact that the heroes of this story were people you wouldn't think of twice. You know, like the kid who was an angel in disguise, Casey, he's the main character. He's an angel, you know. He's not going to be conformed with, so they're working on him, right? They're working on, you know, putting psychiatrists with him and all this, trying to figure him out to get him to be, you know. And his parents are working on him, and they're working on him. All of a sudden, like Carrie, like Stephen King's Carrie, he starts coming into his powers as an angel. And just, oh boy, that makes them so mad. And so he was the real hero. So it's all about this issue, isn't it? It's all about that. I had people take me out at a party I went to with Christian. I had them, they took me out in the back, the men, you know, the old boys. Yeah, they took me out in the back to give me the what for, you know, regarding their book. And said, don't you know what kind of trouble you get in writing that? Why don't you just settle down, you know, become part of what's going on here. And then like a year or two later, you can write a book. You know, but this, don't you know what kind of trouble this is going to bring you? You know, this book. So it's like a real thing in a world of books that are all fake. It's actually something. Well, I like sci-fi because those are books that are, you know, they're metaphors, right? So they're allowed to go a little further with truth. And many books do deal with truth, but not on this particular issue, they don't. So it was, you know, the idea that the disconnected and, you know, they say, well, you know, look at so-and-so. They would name somebody. There was a big Christian author, you know. They would name, I can't even remember them, but you know how they have, like, some of these authors have, like, daily advice from, you know, they lifted up Charles Spurgeon. I used to have Spurgeon, a daily Spurgeon email to me, you know, for inspiration, and it was fine, you know. Now there's one, and, you know, you can't put that guy down. I said, I wasn't putting him down. I just did a story. I'm not putting people down here. Oh, then I showed the church where they did a satanic ritual sacrifice and orgy in the church. And then there was a church connection to the UFOs and Satan. So I guess the people that took issue were the people that run the church system or whatever. They said, you know, you talk about all these kind of losers as being heroes. No, they're not. You know, losers, you know, the homeless guy, the, you know, there was a salesman who got the call and woke up. There was all kinds of different people in there, but all they saw was this one issue. They could only see that one issue over and over. Folks, these people are obsessed with that one issue. Obsessed! To the point where the church becomes a murderer and wants to murder anybody of the Lord and keep the people confused and traumatized. And they target any, you know what I'm, they just couldn't stand that there was a free book written that just kind of freely was just laying it out, you know, not consciously laying it out or not trying to convince anyone of anything, just telling a story. But they got so mad, and that's why they turned on it in the hopes that no one would read it, that it would just be an obscure book and they got their wish in that regard. You know, that would not convince anyone of anything. I wasn't trying to convince anybody. I was just calling them as I see them. That those people, and oh, none of the people that were tapped by God were Christians originally. Isn't that something? Yeah, God just bypassed that Christian thing. Now, I didn't do it on purpose, because back then I was still grappling. I was still traumatized. I was still upset. I was trying to go find a church to go to. I wasn't making that call back then. But all the ones who were wearing masks, you know, were demasked, and they're just seething, angry, murderous people. Couldn't believe it. So angry they were that I would dare to suggest that being a slave of Satan wasn't appropriate if you're a child of God. And that's the issue that we've been revolving around now for months and months and months. I said I wasn't going to talk about it again. I guess you fence sitters are really, really tuning into this. But, I mean, that's what it ended up being, isn't it? Now, I might have suggested that in the book, but I certainly didn't harp on it. But they just, you see, I just a little pinprick was all they needed to come unraveled. A little pinprick. A little, you know, droplet of truth. And they became all unraveled, the Christians. They just came unraveled. And then they try another approach. They say, who wants to read a boring book? This is a boring book. This guy's a lousy writer. It's a boring book. You know, so they would go that route to try to, you know, use Amazon and whatnot as a way to tune people out of it, you know. And the people that had given it a good read, some people read it many times over. They know it's good. You know, it's well written. Has a literary quality to it. That's. I bet you know my knowledge of language is probably pretty good. You know, if people want, you know, are old school, they want a decent read rather than the pedantic read. You know, it's got that going for it. It's got nice layers to it as far as you know the craft of storytelling. But you know that day I was taken out in the back at this sort of barbecue. I was taken over to the side there And I was lectured by the old men. You know, they wanted to tell me about that book. They did not want that thing published. Don't you know what kind of trouble that'll get you in? And then later I found out, yes, it got me in a lot of trouble because it was a story about God, God. And the Christians are intolerant of God, you know. The whole purpose of the Christian church is an outpost to hate God. It's a place where they can gather and they can, you know, hope that children of God walk in there so they can destroy their innocence. And they're just waiting like ravenous wolves. Oh yes, I think we know that they're demasked. I think we know that the Lord is looking at them right now, this very second. They are naked before him, and all their deeds are known. You see, those of you who are civilians out there, this is not your fight, so you stay out of it. This is something God is doing with his people. Because these people proclaim the gospel all day long in their steepled buildings. And they proclaim the gospel all day long in their preaching and their sermons. They proclaim it all day long while they're scalping souls right and left. I mean, let's face it. God knows those people are being harmed. And if the only way to get rid of that harm is to destroy the United States of America, then so be it. So be it. If the only way to destroy those churches is to take out the United States and have it overrun with, you know, rioters and immigrants or whatever, he'll do it. He will do it. Make no mistake. God is no respecter of persons. What you reap, what you've sown, that's what you're going to reap. You reap what you've sown. Comprende. Sí. This issue is nothing to fool around with, children. Nothing to fool around with. You do not, You know, you may not want to deal with it right now, and you want to go out and party, you want to go out and do whatever you're going to do, fine. Just let me give you some advice, those of you who are, you know, this will be the most important advice that you were ever given in your entire life. So listen up. Here it comes. Even if right now they want you to join them mocking and doing this and that and hurting people to kind of, you know, be one of the cool cats, right? You know what I'm talking about, the nasty, the sort of the extension of high school. Okay, don't do it. Don't mock. Don't laugh. Because you see, you'll be next. You know, so you got to get all that treatment and more. So don't do that. You be there, have your party, have your sex, whatever. What is it? What else you want? A TV set? Get your TV set, or your new iPhone, or whatever it is. Your or a new dress, or a new pair of shoes, or a new hairdo, a new look. I guess I'm talking to women now. Go ahead and have it up. But look, that one thing they want you to join in on, that sort of gang bullying thing, don't do that. Find a way to not be there when that happens. So, you're going to have to look the other way, yes. You're not going to be able to criticize. I'm sure, I'm not saying blend in, but just don't be there when that starts. Don't have your hands bloody with the blood of innocence when you want to approach, because one day you're going to need God, see? One day you will get the call. One day God will reach in and touch you. It'll be your time. And you don't want to have that on your hands on that day. I mean, you know, on a day where, you know, you could have, but, you know, it didn't work out and now you're forever suffering. You don't, because see, all these friends and youth and everything, youth leaves you. They want you to join the witch's circle. Don't do it. Because the witch's circle exists just to mock God. That's really 99% of why they're there. They're the police. It's not funny, though. Now, you will never hear another podcast like this for the rest of your life. Indeed, there are none.
Well, how can this exist? It should have been shut down.
Who can even understand what I'm talking about? They don't even understand. I told you, the reptilians are slow. They don't get it. You know what I mean? They're slow. They don't get what... When you're on it, they don't reckon... The truth isn't believed. They don't believe it anyway. They just... Ah, crazy guy. You know. Well, you know, you flat earthers are welcome here, but I understand what's going on, you know. Let's agree that, you know, we have a kind of a matrix type thing here, and that we've been lied to our whole lives about what reality is. Okay, let's cut to the chase that it's God's reality anyway. He's in charge. We know he's there. So we know we can rely on him, and that, you know, basically where he has us is okay because he put us here. We got to deal with him to get out of here. Whether it's a lie, whether your teachers lied to you and all that, well, of course they did. I mean, of course it's all being one big Disneyland lie. Okay, fine. But the thing is, we still have to go through it because God put us here to do that for his purpose. And home isn't here. Obviously, you know, home is, when I point up there, my home is up there. I mean, it's the totality of what up there means. That's my home. I know that's hard to understand. It's like up there is the throne of God, but the throne of God is the totality of everything there is. It's very hard to conceptualize if you're a 3D cave dweller. And it's fine, whatever the Lord has me. You know, I've gotten to the point where, okay, it's fine. And even when I look back on any kind of suffering from all this kind of stuff that happened, you know, this gauntlet I seem to have gone through, and I barely made it with my life, you know, and close calls all the time. I really learned I had to hold on to Father, every step of every day, because it was just so treacherous. And I see the other, you know, young people, and I see them going out, and I see them having their dates and going to dinner and going on vacations, and such a nice world for them. Wow, you know. Wow, that's amazing. It's a whole other world there for people that aren't being harassed. Look at the freedom they have to go and laugh and go to concerts and movies, and it must be just a wonderful world that some people just seem to not be allowed in. And you'd watch them go to on the Ferris wheel, and you'd watch them walk down on the Santa Monica Pier, populated with all these people and all their self-importance and all their things they were involved in and all the important tasks they were doing in the world, and how they were, you know, they were working here and they were working in Hollywood and they were doing this and they were doing that, and it all seemed so important. And they were having their dinners, and I'd observe them in these fancy restaurants, and there they were just talking about the weather and talking about the vacation and or talking about shop talk about the movie they're working on or the production or the this or the that, and you know, it's all so important, and you know, and we're name dropping, and you know, or just talking about their upcoming vacation, and you know, and they were, you know, using they were eating, you know, Vietnamese food or Chinese food or whatever. They were experts with the chopsticks, and they were, you know, so kind of sophisticated at such young ages. Almost like they missed childhood entirely. They just sort of skipped to that stage. But to them, it was just all a big adventure. And they're riding on the ride, and I could see their wind was in their hair, and they were going up the roller coaster and then down and all around and laughing and scared and, you know, having fun and wondering who they're going to marry and where they're going to live. And they're talking about real estate and houses and children and schools. And I mean, you just name it. It was just like a cornucopia of all kinds of activity. I can tell you that. I mean, someone like me who comes from somewhere else, being able to witness all that, that's really something. But never mistake that you're not allowed to have that kind of experience. That's not going to be my experience. No, it was already ruined for me. So, you know, but was it ruined, or was it, you know, when you see the truth, you see, then of course, you know, that's you're barred from that sort of thing, from that togetherness, that sense of family, and that sense of, you know, of love and compassion and understanding and you know, hope and goodness and all those things. Wow. So from that perspective, I realized, well, that couldn't be true. The scenario they're in, they're just like, they don't realize that they're deluded, do they? That this whole experience here isn't what they're playing the part. And they're going through it like it's all real, but it's just a ride at Disneyland. It's not real. I want to tell them that. Hey, wait a second. If it's not true for all of us, it can't be true. It can't be true. You know, some of us see, and you know, then you're not allowed on that ride. It can't be true, you people. You're deceiving yourselves. There is no magic kingdom. It's just a thin veneer over a hellish situation. You see? You see, I knew it just couldn't be true, but I would observe them and I'd dress like them and look like them and mirror them completely. Only to see that it was system-wide. So many of these people also happy, and so serious too, you know, so dedicated, you know, so not even a question that it wasn't real. It's all the stoplights and the you know, the interview with the boss and trying to get the next job, and then having that dinner celebration of, hey, I got the job, and isn't that awesome, and you know, my BMW thing went through, and I got that, and I got, And it's just so cool. I'm living down at Venice now, and it's just awesome. And work is really close now because that, you know, everyone's kind of moved down to Venice, and it's just really, you know, it was like that. It was like that. I was watching all this stuff, you know, watching it all. And I you know, and every once in a while there'd be, here's one who can see. And there'd be this sort of, you know, detection. And then I'd sort of back away, you know, and then I'd come at another time, you know, dress the part, and I'd be able to watch. And I just kept watching because I wanted an answer, okay, people? I wanted an answer. So I disguised myself as, you know, someone in the world or someone, you know what I mean? I'd be like them. I'd try to look like them and talk like them and, you know, interact with them. I wanted to understand what happened, what the discrepancy is, where this borderline is. What the hell is this? It's very supernatural, very interdimensional. So I had to understand, what is this? And they stayed in character for the most part, and they believed their own script they were going from eventually, you know, after enough time doing it. So they actually believed that they were entitled to this life, when the entire thing, what they didn't understand was all of this and all the restaurants and all the circus part of it and all the entertainment and all the, you know, all of it was really there so that people like me could see the truth of it, I guess, in a weird way. That if we weren't there, it wouldn't exist because there'd be no need for it. Right? There'd be no need to keep convincing them that they've got this wonderful world. And then, you know, of course, the tears come later, you know, and I understand that. But, I mean, I wanted to understand when I returned back to Los Angeles after all this stuff happened, and I tried to, you know, kind of back-engineer it, you know. I wanted to go piece by piece like a detective because I remembered everything, you know, but I acted like, of course, I was deluded. And now I'm straight, now I can see, everything's fine, and there was never any such thing as Satanism or satanic abuse or gang stalking. That was all just, you know, obviously I was mistaken, so I was able to go back and then kind of like a detective kind of put it together piece by piece by piece by piece. And it took, you know, 30, 40 years to do that. Well, because you see, when it would flip into another dimension and they would all change, because when they would change into the stalker type, when the mask would come off, it wasn't that they suddenly, you know, because they did it all in unison, it's the dimension flipped. So they're not the same people that they were. You see, that was one, I know, that's... you know, I think... I can see that now in retrospect that, you know, I was going to be a long time, you know, before I actually understood that interdimensional thing. I mean, I'd see it flip, but I still wouldn't understand what it is. How a person could go from that to suddenly they were a demon, like, you know, how I could have a conversation with, like, the neighbor. And then one day I'm driving along, she goes, what are you doing out by yourself? Or some kind of snide comment like that. And is that the same person that was, we were neighbors and friends? I mean... I didn't understand that. It was an allusion to this whole thing, you know, which that's the problem. It was an allusion to this whole thing. Had it been equipped like, you know, oh, having a good hair day and then my hair is really messed up. I mean, that would be normal kind of, you know, chiding, you know, which is fine with me. You know, I'm not. It's when it goes, when it alludes to this situation, then I want to investigate. I want to find out what exactly do you know about it? See, what I'm finding out now, at long last, I'm finding out that they don't really understand. It scares them, and all they know is that they've got to kind of go along to get along, but as far as what it is, they've given up looking into it themselves because they just have accepted it as an interdimensional thing they have no control over, but they can't tell anyone else about it. And so that's about, you know, I mean, I learned that many years ago, probably when I was, you know, in my 20s or so, that it was like they've given up on investigation. They're just like, well, that's the way it is. And, you know, and I'm, you know, dent, no biggie. And I'm going to have my fun and graduate from my university and I'm going to have my little life. But I would often wonder, I'd watch them, and I'd wonder, well, when do they feed? You know, since they have to feed. And then that's when they coalesce like coyotes, you know, around a rabbit. And so I'd see that happen, and I make sure I wasn't there like as that target, you know, but I'd see them kind of go into that, you know, and talk about how they were going to target somebody, and, you know, figuring I was like on their side, like there's two sides, you know, but you're not supposed to know there's two sides. So there was all this kind of secrecy involved. And I just wondered, well, what's the root of all this? Is it the military-industrial complex? And that's all part of it, too. You know, that's all connected. And the alien thing is completely connected, you know, the hybrids. And the kingdom of Satan. It's all managed by this other dimension and that manages this one. And so all those decisions to do this or do that, or all of those are being regulated and controlled. You know, nobody has their own decision. They're all being, you know, remote controlled. And that's about the point where, that's about all I need to know right there. So that a person could flip into one dimension and go, say some really rude, horrific comment that alludes to a situation that would trigger you in whatever way you need to be triggered. Then they go back to us being their sweet selves in the next moment with almost like no recollection of what just happened. It's not because they're the same person. They're not the same person they were just 10 seconds earlier. It's two different people, or three, or 100, or 1,000,000, or whatever they need to project. They are merely a projection, you know, a prop that's sent in by somebody off screen, off the stage. And I've talked to one guy that was just saying that, you know, he felt that that there were even subtle differences physically. Like when they'd flip, you know, you'd see someone, they go, you're not the guy who was just here a minute ago. And you'd see like the mole is different, or say he was describing that. And then I was looking back through my life, and it's like, yep, I noticed that too. I never really spoke about it, but now that he's spoken about it and told me about it, I was like remembering, well, yes, I noticed that too. I just didn't say anything. So what I'm suggesting here in this very, very deep and prophetic podcast is that if this is true, then all bets are off. Number one, I'm just so grateful again to be, you know, that my father is the one who created all this. So he's my father. He created all. He runs the show. And, you know, there's a reason for suffering. You know, my suffering, when I did, helped me to love my brother. You know, I mean, really, it wasn't like I'm loving out of pity. No, I genuinely love my brother, which I couldn't do without the suffering, without the breaking. So you see what I mean? And all that's meant for harm, the Lord will use for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Do you realize that, folks? Everything that was meant for harm with me, I've nothing but rejoicing now, because it all worked to make me a better soul who genuinely loves his brother when the love wasn't there. I was embarrassed by him and maybe even ashamed. I'm not ashamed to say that. It's okay now because I became him, you see. It's like I went through the very thing that I allowed him to go through, you know, by not sticking up for him. And so I went through it myself. And I learned what it was to be him. And it's terrible, but at least, you see, it's okay now. You know, that proved the love for my brother. That restored us, even though he's not here. He was murdered. So, you know, he's here with me. That without that breaking, without all the things that happened, I would not be able to love my brother for real, you know, the real deal, not the fake lip service thing, but the real thing. Couldn't happen. Could not happen. Would not happen without everything that's happened. With, you know, with this, you know, and so I, in a sense, I put myself through it, and I used, oh, here comes the thing that people don't want to talk about, but here you go. Yes, I controlled it all. All the people that did whatever they did, I used them, you see, to hurt me. Because I had to be hurt in order to grow in that, you know, to have that love come forth. Without that hurt, I wouldn't have worked. So in some sense, I, you know, God allowed it, or if you like, equally accurate would be, I put myself through it. Because that's what I needed. My needs have changed now. You know, the job well done, you know, mission accomplished. And now my own personal journey, it's on to the next thing, which is, you know, learning how to be crippled and walk. You know, learning how to laugh despite circumstances, learning how to lighten my heart, learning how to flaunt whatever rather than be ashamed, you see. No, I mean, all that was just like stuff people did. I didn't do it. I was watching it happening. I was wondering, how come this part of reality is never talked about? Do they think they're operating in secret? Because this is what the Lord is really keen on. This is the thing he watches. This is the whole reason for the Word of God, about how in Psalm 2 it says that, you know, the world conspires against, you know, the world, the kings of the earth, of the leaders, meaning the establishment, conspires against God and his anointed. So it really is a conspiracy. It's really system-wide. Yes, it's system. It's the entire thing. It's everything. It's everyone, everywhere. Well, then why were those people talking about satanic ritual abuse and mind control and multiple personalities and handlers, you know, down the street or over there or over there, when it's everything and everyone and everywhere? How come they did that? Because they're deceivers. They're presenting a false reality that does not exist. Yeah, but they were on my show. They have their churches, they have their baptisms, they have their, they preach on the Word of God. You know, are you listening? No, I'm not listening. Well, and you wouldn't, because there's nothing there, they're dead. Well, that's pretty harsh. Hey, if they're on the other side of that line, they're dead. It's just, there's no little bit pregnant. You either are or you aren't, you know, you either belong or you don't. They go, well, how do you feel when you're watching all that and you're watching all the people trying to understand what this is here? And how is that profound sense of not belonging? And I say, well, I never had that. I always felt, you know, I belong somewhere. And now it turns out I belong with my Lord, my Father, my way, my peace, my truth. My life is completely dependent, because without the Father there, you see, I wouldn't even be here saying anything. I just have to figure he wants me to say, wants me to lance the wound today. Well, you see, throughout time and history, you know, people have always, you know, it's ironic that we talk about the left here, and, you know, I suppose tangentially that doesn't really mean liberals, but liberals have always been for the little guy and the underclasses, and are they ever going to have a voice? Well, the real meek of the earth aren't those people, and not even the poor. They're the downtrodden are really the people of God, who get picked on and targeted and lied to and set up, and, you know, not people that would be religious. You know what I mean? And how come there's never a movie or a book about them? You know there isn't. Well, there are, Brother Z. They have the underclasses as the metaphor for them. Yeah, but how come there isn't just a literal thing about all this? You know, about watching them in their Disneyland world, and watching them go through their motions and having their marriages and having their graduations and, you know, watching and just wondering, what does all that mean? You know, I've had the pleasure of that kind of point of view. I've also been on the inside, where I had the graduation and I had the, you know, so I've been on both sides, right? And I can just tell you this, it may be a lot easier being deluded and asleep and hypnotized and hypnotized and controlled. But remember this, folks, when you get jealous, you know, or when there's a pang of jealousy that you're not included, just remember this, that none of those people, not even one, are thinking their own thoughts, not one. All of them are subject to interdimensional shifting and moving. They're just actors on the Truman Show. They've convinced themselves in putting on the act. They never even stopped to figure, who are they acting for? And what is this? If they say things like that, then they too could get kicked out, see? If they wake up, they get kicked out, you know? If they tell the truth, they get kicked out. You don't have to be like wearing Jesus on your sleeve to be targeted. Absolutely not. I'm sorry if I gave that impression. Yes, you're a child of God, but you don't have to know that. You could be, technically, you could think you're a Satanist even, or a scientist or something, whatever. You know, you start to understand when you get pummeled, though, don't you? And then you start figuring out what it's all about, right? The more separate that you are from the pummeling, as they turn the hoses on you, they turn on you. It's like the Joni Mitchell song. They're going to turn the hoses on you. Yeah, they turn on you. Suddenly. And you're out. And then you're down. If you slip or you get sick or you have a financial reversal, don't worry, you'll be on the outside from that. But then what's the lesson there? You know, then you have to become the observer. You have to understand, well, what is this that I was a part of there? And then why so mean? What did I, you know? Well, they'll get to the point where they'll put a restraining order on you if you push it, you know. But this is where I used to go. Well, they don't want you there anymore. You got sick. Something bad happened to you. You suddenly woke up. You woke up from the deep slumber. You started seeing that things weren't as they seem. You started having eyes to see and ears to hear, and you couldn't handle the information that you were getting, and people were distancing themselves by and by as that process continued. Then pretty soon, when you finally woke up and you wanted to tell them the truth, hey, I figured it out, everybody. They shut you down. They said bad things about you. They got you in trouble. They silenced you, and you were never to be heard from again. And they shut your mouth before you had a chance to open it. Before you could figure out what was really happening, they became evil with murderous intent toward you, almost like some monster that you don't recognize turning on you out of nowhere. And then you start to understand what this is all about, don't you? You see, a lot of you were tuning in because you see what this is all about now from that unfortunate side of life. Something happened to you, some reversal. Something happened there, and all of a sudden you could see, you were shaken awake. And now, you know, you're tuning in here, you're looking everywhere you can for information about what the hell's going on. Indeed, hell is the operative word. You're in hell, my friend. And it doesn't do any good thinking about, well, in a past life, did you do something wrong? You're here now in the realm of Hades, and you're going to have to find a solution. And there is one, Jesus. You're going to have to, you know, that's the one thing you've been offered, and the Word of God. And you're just going to have to, like, even if you've always mocked that yourself, you're going to have to go that direction, because that's the only way you're getting out of here in one piece. I mean, just take it from me. Well, if you just think, okay, God, if I just pray or whatever, but watch how it evolves. You know, you'll eventually come to know. You don't have to right now say, oh, I believe the story exactly. No, you don't. Be honest. You say, Father, here's where I suggest starting. Things have gotten really bad, Lord. You know, all the friends have left me and family, and I didn't know what happened. I just kind of woke up, and then all of a sudden, people were so mean. I don't understand. I need to find out what's going on, Lord. I just, like, if you're there, I'll just go with you. I have no moves I can make. I can't win against this. It's like a big machine. It just crushes people right and left with no regard for anything. Help me, Father. Lord, are you there? Do you exist, God? Start there. Ask him if he exists. Because one way or another, you got to become friends. You got to bond with the Lord. Because people aren't, even people that are on the same spiritual path, they're not going to be able to talk to you because everyone's separated. In real reality, you know, we're all separated by time, space, and circumstance. It's kept that way for a reason. No, not the enemy keeping us separated. God keeps us like that. Because when we get together, bad things happen, typically. Well, we get together on occasion, but I mean, it's not like they socialize with a collective. Because, you know, it's just a place where it becomes the devil's playground. You know, I know people that are really good people. When they get around other people, the worst of them comes out. Oh, disguised as an angel of light, of course. So what I'm talking about are universal truths here. Okay. So let's back up and say, what has Zeph been talking about the last hour and a half or so? I've been talking about the universal truth of our existence. And, you know, anyone who wakes up, anyone who has a calamity, who wakes up, usually the calamity and the waking up go hand in hand. I always say it's the Lord breaking you. You know, when you wake up, the people that you were, your friends, your family, they reject you immediately before you have a chance to speak. They don't want you to speak at the dinner table. They don't want you to speak at all. They'll say, like my mother used to do, she'll say, hey, you know, I already know. You already know? How come you didn't tell me about the gang stalking then, you know, when it was going? Because I'm doing it to you. You and how many others? Everyone is in on it. It's a dimension. It's, you're a fool to fight it. Well, what do you want me to do? Here, kill yourself. Here's a gun. Literally, there's been incidents like that. You know, at least have the, you know, be like your brother. Oh, man, yeah. And some of the other days said, well, but you're a fighter. You know, you're like, you know, not everyone's a fighter. I am not a fighter. I mean, maybe in some sense I am in the spiritual soul realm a fighter, I guess. But it wasn't like that. It was more like my soul, wasn't going to, you know, go along with killing itself or being stolen or taken. The soul was more powerful than me. It was almost like I was overridden by my own soul is really what it was. You know, because I didn't really have anything to fight with. I was scared to death of all this stuff. Spooky as can be, like living in a horror movie. I would look at them and study them, and I wondered, how can they take it every day? And the answer is, most of the time, they're not in that mode. Most of the time, they're in the kind of Disneyland mode. And so they're fine. But their lives are not their own. Friend, let me just say it one more time so that you understand. Numero uno. The people on that stage, the people you're watching, how can they all have these anesthetized, kind of like live in the bubble life, and they all seem so gay and thrilled and focused and all that? Well, the reason they can be like that is because their lives are not their own. Best way I can put it. They're there because you're observing them. And you think you're seeing something real, but you're not. You see what I mean? They seem undetectable, so they're so good at the acting. How can they do that? And it's there to convince you that you're wrong, you see, and that you're a loser, and that you ought to just off yourself. But that would be false information, because what you're seeing isn't real anyway, so you're basing your cosmological view on what you're observing, which is false to begin with. So you're in a double conundrum, man. You've doubly deceived yourself into thinking you're missing out on something. Nobody's missing out on anything. Your life is what's going on. And that's ground zero. That's the center of attention right there. All this is happening because of your life. I know that gets complicated, but I mean, that's basically more accurate, that statement, than you revolve around them. The fact is, they revolve around you. And if you don't need to see them having fun, then they'll put another scene in front of you. They'll put Okay, you can see the world, say, at war. You can see it, whatever they need to show you to put you into, to manipulate you, they'll do. And these are just like pictures in a, you know, sitting there in the movie theater, having your reality doled out to you. You're actually asleep and not even unaware. You know, your waking state is a dream state. And what you're seeing are things they're projecting in front of you. And they're controlling the whole thing. When you think you go somewhere, you do something, you do no such thing. You're sleeping. And when you finally start seeing it that way, now you're closer to actual reality than you even know. Now you're almost there. And the last step you're not going to get until unto death, you know. Death is really a birth. Death is the awakening. You know, you're not actually dying, you're actually waking up. It's, I know. Look, I've spent so many years studying all this, more than anyone, you know, probably. I've never read a philosophical journal or any of the great philosophers of the past or any of the modern ones or anyone who actually, I mean, advanced the whole notion of reality beyond Plato's cave story. I mean, that was still stands as probably the most accurate. And you know, of course, from philosophy, we should find answers. And, you know, the best answer that you know, we have from, you know, the Socrates situation is we have, you know, we're in a cave and we see shadows on the wall. And we make assumptions based on shadows that are not real. That's a beautiful working metaphor that everything I've said fits completely into that paradigm exactly. So I think you're in good stead. Very good stead. If you believe that you're not seeing it accurately with your senses, then you're in pretty good shape, but you need to see it further that, you know, it's God's will that we go through this. And then so you agree, okay, instead of looking for the exit, I'm just going to go through it. Okay, God, you just lead me where you want me to go. We're in some kind of a waking dream, you know, that's being manipulated from where we can't see by others. And we don't know who the others are or another or something out there. So as I wrap up this one, I have a word to say about the flat earth, round earth, all this earth stuff and cosmos. It doesn't really matter what you believe about it. That's my conclusion anyway. I have no opinion. I'm dealing with this reality. I'm dealing with this oppression right now of cognition and I don't want to be oppressed. You know, I don't want to, but I feel less oppressed than I ever did because I understand when I'm observing something that makes me feel like either left out or, you know, I'm having missed out on life or any of those kind of things. All that's fake. I didn't miss anything. I've been at the center of it all from the very beginning. You know, it's everything around me has been my own orchestration. I have agreed to all of it. I have been a part of casting this play. I've written the play. Everything about it is me. There's nothing for. I recognize the images that I see. In the form of people or people's conversations. They're so often what I need to hear at that moment, almost like I had written the script for them to speak. Well, I have. And then I haven't. And it's very mysterious in that way. But the point I'm trying to make is that's what it is. And, you know, thank God we have an aging thing happening here so that we can wake up. Because otherwise you can't wake up. You have to be perpetually asleep. So there's a waking up part. It's called, you know, old age. Or calamity. But anyway, people are concerned about the flat earth, round earth, and all that other thing. And I just think that craze on YouTube, especially of the flat earth thing. And you have Christian ministers stepping in and going with the biblical view, and they really believe they're right in all this. And it's like, I just believe that there's so many things going on besides that. I think, let's not, it was like this, it's the same thing as the Saturn thing. It was like a distraction, you know. You know, you go, well, NASA lied to us. It's like, well, who hasn't? And I also recognize that the flat earth thing is an awakening. So that there's a positive aspect to it. What it actually turns out to be in the end, well, you know, you won't know until you wake up. And since none of us are awake in this realm, you know, we can only, you know, guess. So that's what I want to leave you with. And, you know, I just praise the Lord that he woke us up and delivered us from, that I understand what it all is. So I don't take it personally, you know, so I understand that I'm, when I see people doing whatever they're doing, I'm actually kind of in a way the author of that. And by knowing, seeing myself as the author, you know, understanding that I was going to go through this and I knew what I was going to go through before I came here and all that, it helps me to realize that, you know, there's no personal intent there. If you were to go follow one of these sock puppets, you find that a lot of cases they don't live anywhere. They don't really exist. I mean, there's that weird mysterious part of it too. I mean, that's not true across the board. And if you do find that someone actually lives somewhere, you know, it's like, is there really a real person there? They seem to live in an apartment and they pay bills and they go here and they go there. But are you really, is that something that you're projecting to yourself to see? I'm making an assumption based on Plato's cave. These are just shadows you're looking at. You don't know what you're looking at. And then you find out, well, someone's throwing it at me from off stage. Well, that someone is us. And that's the other weird, you know, mystery solved on that. And so you can say, well, I don't want to be here. I want to wake up. Well, the only way anyone wakes up here is through death. Until then, you're still in the cave making assumptions about what's out there. You know, you're seeing shadows flickering on the wall from the firelight. You're not looking at the actual thing itself. And the things that you see are just like you putting projections up. Oh, I need to see them on the merry-go-round. I need to see them at the workplace, in the cafeteria, in the courtroom. I need to see them here and there. I need to see this or that in the news, so that's what pops up on my screen. I need to see the Drudge Report. I need to see the migrant problem in Europe. I need to have blame to go around to the politicians and to the Obama and the Soros thing and the left and the right. You know, I started off talking about all that, but then I went deeper today. And then all that now is irrelevant to me because obviously the Lord took me to what is relevant. And then, of course, all the externalities like politics, various personalities, they're just characters I created. You know, I create a villain for us not to like, and I create a hero for us to look up to, and whatever I need, you know, in this journey is going to be provided, you know, to get the job done. Well, what already has been done is, like I say, I became my brother so I could love my brother. It could only be done through trauma and through pain and suffering. And so, mission accomplished, it's time to clean up the wounds now, but win-win. If I die, I win. If I live, I win. I never lose. I can't lose. Everything is win. When I make music, it's win-win because I'm happy, you know, to create and to figure stuff out. I love figuring out, you know, to have songs and things. And so it's just, you know, it's not really that important. It's just something that I learned to laugh again, you see. Well, it beats crying for the rest of your life. I know people have literally cried for most of their lives. from the traumas, you know, multiple personalities, you know, obviously you have to be very traumatized, very hurt by others, you know, to become a multiple. Well, in the ultimate sense, I mean, you know, in the ultimate sense, I gang stalk myself, but I mean, see, we have multiplicity, and there's another part of this conversation before we went that deep to I am God. We're almost to that point, but let's back it up. The Lord hates these bullies. And he hated that in me, and he broke, boy, I'll tell you, he broke me down, and he got rid of that, but quick. And if I ever start, you know, in like that, he'll break me again. So he hates that worse than anything. When the mocking that Job complained about, and the mocking that Jeremiah complained about, and the mocking that so many others following God complained about. That's where the Bible's so crucially good. Many other texts, like, you know, the Eastern texts and all, they don't have this kind of critical stuff in there like that. Anyway, the Lord detests that more than, because you're mocking him, you know, and you know how kids are. They find the odd one, and then they gang up. And if the kid survives all that, then, you know, a lot of times that kid will go and overachieve and become like the boss. So he can just hire these people just to fire him. You know, there has been vengeance like that. But even more so, the Lord will make these people as if they never were. I mean, he will decimate them and show them what it's like to be on the other end of that bullying. Nobody gets away with it. I'm just here to warn the entire world. Don't even try it. You know, you want to shoot down planes and act like someone else did it and point the finger, you're going to get your asses kicked. I mean, but good. Because the Lord won't tolerate that. You know, or whatever kind of other kind of deceptive thing you're doing out there. He will not allow the U.S. military to have a victory so long as they keep behaving in that manner. They will deny themselves victory again and again. We lost in Iraq, Afghanistan. Everything we've done, we lose. Even others are coming. I'm not the only one. I used to be the only one that said that. Now you got everybody chiming in with that. You know, that which is high will be brought low, i.e. the United States, and that which is low will be brought high, you know, the meek of the earth. So if you want to be meek, you know, you align with God, because you can't be with God unless you're meek, because he will make you meek. it's not an option. There is no, like, optional meekness. No, you cannot be at Esau around God. You can't be a strong man. No, I'm weak, you know, I'm broken. I'm traumatized, I'm scarred. You know, I have flashbacks and stuff. You know, it's bad. But in him, see, I have this strength to be able to communicate this message, you know, better than anyone else on earth. I mean, I hate to put it that way, but it's true. I hate to put it that way because it sounds like I'm boasting, but I'm not boasting. I don't feel boastful in my spirit when I say this. It just literally is true. It may not be your cup of tea, and that's fine. You know, I couldn't take this podcast probably for more than a couple of times at once. It's just too much. But it is a shot of truth. If you need to mainline that truth, you know, you're going to get a good dose of it here, and it's going to go all the way to even where the philosophers went and where pop psychology went. Well, a lot of assumptions that you made that don't quite fit in the Judeo-Christian paradigm or in the Bible, you might think. But then when I say this other stuff and put it all together, then it all makes sense. To the person that has a ear. Now, there's other people out there that say things. For example, to me, the story of Don Quixote is just pure truth. It's just pure insane genius. It's beyond belief how wonderful that story is at describing everything we've talked about and even more, the implications of it. So, you know, I'm not suggesting I'm the only one that has a truth. There's lots of truth out there in stories, in the Bible, and this and that and the other thing. And I'll be the first to admit, but I'm just saying, you will not get it, this particular area, explained better. And to the untrained observer, it'll sound like gobbledygook. Because it's a lot of it's kind of, in a way, coded. You have to have a certain knowledge to be able to access this stuff here, but it's really for people that are waking up and they're they're troubled and they, you know, realize that, you know, their whole life has been a lie, and, you know, they're now willing to deal with that. Well, the rocks start being thrown. You know, it's very important to the world to remain asleep and in darkness. And, you know, when you upset the apple cart and you're waking up and they're not, they will shun you. Okay, because that little boast of mine or whatever it was pretty dramatic, I think I'll just take it back then so there's no confusion. The reason I say that is because I've searched the internet thoroughly to try to find something like this podcast, and I haven't found it, you know, but perhaps it's just because this is what I need to hear. And, you know, other people need to hear something else. Maybe for some people, the flat earth is a way of waking up. Maybe for other people, you know, some old time, you know, gospel sermon is a way to wake up. I don't know. I just know that I couldn't awaken, I couldn't be at peace unless I understood where this awful thing of the bullying and gang stalking. I had to find out what the heck, what's going on there, and, you know, setting people up and murders, and it was, I didn't understand, because it seemed like the people perpetrating all that were nice people. What, how'd they change so radically? How'd they become like that, where they would, you know, do, how, I don't understand. See, so that inquiry brought me to certain points of view, or certain ways of looking at it, or framing it up, that could communicate what you're looking at in a way so that you don't take it personally, but you realize that you've been involved in it the whole time. Meaning, you know, you're the stalker and the stalkee, you know, ultimately. You needed to go through that. Like I said, for me, it was like the I could not love my brother unless I went through just exactly what he went through. Now, this is kind of a common theme out there, this going through what you, right? We've seen stories like that. I can't tell you right now the story, but this is kind of a common thing. It's not so rare, not so unique. And then I thank God for it, because the ability to love my brother is more important to me in terms of just being at peace. And in so doing, I also let go of the, you know, I don't approve of the people that were the actors involved in doing their evil acts, but I don't really, you know, they kind of faded away. The act remains, and the scars remained, but the actual person that did this or that, I just feel very sorry for them, because they acted against their own will. I mean, they had to, you know, they were recruited to behave in a way that would be completely anathema and the opposite of who they really are. But didn't that throw you for a loop when you'd see people suddenly manifest in a way that, you know, you've known them all your life, and then all of a sudden you saw a side that was monstrous, and you couldn't believe it. Was that the sweet little, you know, really? And then they are down at the, you know, down in the woods at the Grove, you know, they're the first one to stick the knife in, right? And laughing and cackling like, and you, that sweet little old lady, really? Oh yeah, buddy. Well, read Young Goodman Brown. This is nothing new. This is, you know, welcome to the NFL. This is really, really the ultimate gauntlet that anyone could ever imagine. And I think we come out of this being better people, amen? Being better souls, I should say, amen? Yes, we come out of this being a better creation. Indeed, I would tell you that this is actually part of creation. You know, you're being created into something that you weren't before, in a sense. This is part of the process. But is it the real world? No, you can look up into space and you can see that space is separate from you. You know, it's out there. You're in here. I look and I wonder every night, because, you know, I say, Lord, someday you're going to show me that, you know, that's home up there, but where? And, you know, people say, well, this home right here, Well, for now, it's home. It's home temporarily, you know, but of course I won't be here forever, so it's not really home. Real home is what I consider something permanent. So this could never be home. I'm just visiting here, and I've sought not to belong to the earth because I'm not an earth dweller. I come from up there. They may come from the earth. I don't know where they come from. I don't even know that they're real. You know, but we know this, that we know that in the back of our minds, we understand that none of this is real. So, and when we get that, my God, that's a liberating thing. You know, just like in nightmares, the oddest things can happen, and people you trusted can show up manifesting as horrible monsters in your dreams, right? That happens. That same very thing happens in this stalking thing. It's just a dream. It's just a dream. The people aren't real. Or they're not who you knew. And once you understand that part of it, then what should happen is it should all open up into view for you. Well, it makes you run to the Lord all the more because you feel like you are completely have no control over it now. It's so beyond, you know, the beyond. It's like, oh, okay, Lord, I'm on my face. I can't do one thing or I can't even take one step without you, Lord. Please, hold on to me, Lord. Please, don't let me go. This is way above my pay grade. When you finally see the mechanism, it's way above our comprehension. And yet, we are targeted. Little old me. What exactly did I, you know, who am I to have got this wonderful gift of targeting? What have I done? You know, what makes me deserve such an honor? And in the end, you're going to end up saying that very thing. Well, maybe it's because you were really a great being. You know, maybe you just had what it took, and maybe the others didn't. Why was Job chosen? Job going to suffer more than most of you. Why was he chosen? And why was he restored so lavishly? Sevenfold and everything. Yeah, just everything. Wow. Why is that so important of a story? Oh boy, it really is. It's just like Don Quixote in a way. Don Quixote is like, you know, going on the spiritual quest, and look how the whole society lined up against him, see? It was all a metaphor for the thing going on. That's why I recommended the Scorch Trials, the Maze Runner, because it's the same metaphor again. You know, well done. Kudos to the author and to the people who wrote the screenplay and took it even further. But, you know, it's at the same time, these guys in the movie, they don't approve of the dead being parasites sucking off the living. That's what the story's about. The dead are sucking off the living to keep going. And they're out there looking for the living soul. They're looking for people that are immune to gather them in and then hook them up to tubes and siphon everything out of them so that they can keep living. Doesn't that sound perfect? Perfect! It's another one. So it's like the vampires or whatever. All these stories are there to help you to wake up, to help you to see the truth. You know, so those people that are having such a good time and, you know, making you feel so left out, let's say, you're going to find one day that you're the one that's on the inside track and that you were never lost and you were never outside. You were never in danger. You were, the Lord had you firmly right there where he wanted you. And then eventually he showed you, you passed the test, son, because, you know, let me show you. And he takes you behind the scenes, just like Walt Disney might at Disneyland, and he shows you how the mechanism works. And none of those people were real. They're all a mechanism. Isn't that something? You're the only one that matters in this situation, though you're taught that you're no big deal. You're a very big deal. They spent how many, I don't even know what you could translate it to into dollars, but it would be trillions just on you. This is all your, you know, experience here. This is all about you. You can come to the realization it's all about him. You know, obviously it's his. You're in his setup, and you ain't getting out of here without him. Yeah. And you and him and you is you, though. It is him, if you like. Whatever. But you're not some sort of helpless victim here. You're going through something that you were supposed to go through. And when you awaken, you realize, like I said, he take you behind the scenes of where that trauma, I mentioned a party I was invited to for the purpose of them completely coalescing and jumping on me, you know, just like Carrie being invited to the prom. I've been through that numerous times, that same setup. Okay, but the Lord takes me back there. And we look at what it is. Realize that none of those people were real and the situation wasn't real. It didn't even happen. It was just part of a dream, you know. And there was, you know, the whole purpose of that was for me. For me, what's the end result of if I could love my brother, right? That's the end result because that's the way he would have been treated. So you see, I set up the very scenario to understand what he went through. And in so doing, my heart was not just broken, as his, of course, was, but now with the capacity to love, it's healed in a way that it could never have been had that not happened. So thank God that happened, you see. I could tell you lots of stories like that. I could tell you how every one of those things was for a purpose, and the purpose has been successful, as I have been very successful in this whole endeavor. You know, the fact that I can articulate all these things despite the protestations from people that wanted me to stop, wanted me not to say anything. It's like, yeah, they don't want you to say anything because, you know, they're living in a dream world where they want to stay asleep and stay hypnotized and lost and make no progress toward anything and spin around uselessly and then die. You know, I mean, that's not what you want to do with this life. Anyway, if they existed, if they actually exist, and I can make a case for, well, they're the same as they in your dreams when you sleep. They're no different than that they. So when you realize that, you don't exactly hold it against them, do you? Because, you know, when you go to see them finally 40, 50 years later, you see you find one of them old and beaten down, and maybe they have like a kind of they're hunched over, or maybe have a, you know, the hunchback almost, you know, kind of showing how the world's weighted them down, and they're maybe walking on a cane. And life has not been exactly kind. Well, you see, in a sense, you're seeing yourself, and they've gone through some traumas, haven't they? And when you see them, to finally confront them on what they did, they look at you and they're sorry and they know what you're talking about, but they're not there like they were to be chastised. It's more like, you know, the response you might get is, I'm so glad you brought that up because I've always felt bad about that and I'm very sorry. So you expected a war, you expected to fight. It turned out that life had beaten them down just the same way it beat you down. And in the end, it's just like this. If we're all in the death room together, we're all going to die. We'd hold each hands, we'd let it all go, and we'd just say, you know, wow, you know, off stage, let's go out and get a pizza after this is over. Right? And then you're not even the same people that you were. You were all actors playing your various parts for the purpose of establishing your souls, obviously, as children of the Most High God, because, you know, that's what's being had with your hearts and your capacity to love, your capacity to exist, your capacity to be real, your capacity to be have fidelity with God. All these things have been worked on through this process, and you have to admit that today you have a lot more going for you than you did before. You have a lot going for you in terms of who you are, the Lord, and what you do, what priorities you have, which you would not have had had it just been all selfishly about you and, you know, and, you know, there's only so long that a person can last running around the world, you know, having, you know, a few laughs and, you know, finding kicks and all that. It's after a while you realize I'm just going around and around on the same ride at Disneyland. I don't get it, you know? And then you realize, hey, I gotta be getting on with it. You know, what is this about? And I need to find out, and I need to find out where I'm headed and get going the right way and, you know, get a move on. So that's why this podcast is universal and for all people. Because all people have the same thoughts in a way. They just don't know how to articulate them. And they want clarity on all these issues because, you know, we've all been bullies too. I mean, we've all been, you know, it's not like when we talk about who deserves what, you know, let's get rid of that word. It's not that we deserve this, that, or the other thing, or that it has to be done because this is the result we need because we were assholes earlier, and now we're humbled, and now we're going to be better people. And, you know, that's one way of looking at it. But none of us, we don't deserve or not deserve. It's got nothing to do with that. It's that this is something we are going through, and it's happening, and it's going to happen, and we've got to get with it. It doesn't matter why, ultimately, do you deserve it, do you not deserve it, who cares? The fact is, you know, when you finally go backstage and you see what's going on with that thing that was coming at you, and you realize, and you see all the paper mache and all the mannequins and stuff, they weren't real. And then you find out that you had something to do with the script, you had something to do with the actual result and the actual thing, that's you. And then you take responsibility for it. You say, okay, Lord, it's still very confusing. I still feel very traumatized by it all. And at the same time, look at the progress. Now, those that want to be professional victims, I run into them. They end up not liking me very much because being a professional victim means you want to stay asleep. And you just want to make it the other guy is evil and you're good, but you're being picked on unfairly. Now, that I cannot indulge in because that's too painful for me. I must get beyond that somehow, but that requires my being a little more awake and, you know, yes, taking responsibility. You know what I mean? It takes going on the journey. If I was to take that kind of attitude, I would not progress on any journey. I would stay stuck in my victimhood, blaming someone, waiting for a savior to come save me. And, of course, we all know what happens when you wait. You know, then I realized, wait a sec, the Savior came and saved me already and I'm still complaining. Oh, geez. The prison door was open and I keep saying, I'm in prison, I'm a victim here, yet the door is wide open. I mean, that's unfortunately what we run into, at least I run into that constantly. That's what's wrong with people in the churches and they feel like, you know, victims of life and they're hanging out there, but they know they should leave and they're stuck. And across the board, I'm telling you, there's this painful thing in humanity that is, you know, what I described today is the very journey that every single being must go through. So those who are Satanists today will eventually not be, you know, I mean, you know, so when I say as if they never were, well, yeah, that does happen, but ultimately, the people that, you know, are persecuting those of the Lord end up not persecuting them, end up being persecuted themselves the very way they persecuted others. That's what happened to Paul exactly. Today I'm describing Paul's journey exactly. Exactly in a way that you can understand, you know, very deeply now. He persecuted, so he had to be persecuted, you see. By the same measure, he put himself through it too. He would speak boldly as he ought to speak, but at times got him in trouble. When he was proving himself to the Lord, but at the same time he was undoing the damage he had done by going through it himself and developing that great compassion and love for others that he did not have before when he was so cruel and unkind and yes, bullying and yes, stalking. Whatever he had done to others was visited upon his own head by him. Now, the cynical Satanist may say something like, you made your choice. You made your bed, now you lie in it. You wanted to go run after Jesus and all that? This is what happens. It's not my fault, but my job is to target you because you made that decision. Had you not made that decision, you wouldn't be seeing me. Though it's not my fault. So you do get that too. And the right response to that is, well, it looks like I chose well. Because any other choice would get no attention whatsoever. This was the one choice. That one choice. Yes. There's that one choice that made all the difference. And that's the choice that offends you so greatly. Oh, come on, Zeph. Now, I thought we got over this. We've had the whole culture gone, and Jesus is out of here. And, you know, this is all about PC, and, you know, just get with the program, get your mind right. All that was just a myth. Just a myth. You're being deluded by a myth. This is what's happening now. We made great progress here. And with that, I bid you shalom, shalom. I love you and praying for you, and I just hope you're going to be able to have a great day. Okay? A great upwelling of the spirit, a great here's one more from Job 12:6. The tabernacles of robbers prosper, and they that provoke God are secure, and to whose hand God bringeth abundantly. Yes, see, that's the perception. But ask now the beasts, and they shall teach thee, and the fowls of the air, and they shall tell thee, or speak to the earth, and it shall teach thee. The fishes of the sea shall declare unto thee, who knoweth not in all these that the hand of the Lord has wrought this? In whose hand is the soul of every living thing and the breath of all mankind? Doth not the ear try words and the mouth taste his meat? With the ancient is wisdom and in length of days understanding. With him is wisdom and strength. He hath counsel and understanding. Behold, he breaketh down. He breaks you. And it cannot be built again. He shutteth up a man and there can be no opening. I rest my case. So we'll see you next time. I'll figure out how to turn this thing off here. Here we go. Shalom.